Good morning, everybody. I want to welcome our online audience. We're glad that you're here joining us on Facebook Live, and as well, everybody that's here gathered together in person as we begin our worship time together. This is Central Christian Church in the way we're meeting now, and so we're glad that you are here. It's a beautiful day, isn't it? And it's a great time of the year to appreciate how God reminds us that he brings new life, not just to creation and the things that are springing to life all around us, but how he does that in people's lives. God takes dry, dusty, what appears to be dead spirits and infuses them with new life. And that's what we're really about, is helping people find that and grow in that, in Jesus. There are just a couple of things coming up that I will mention to you. 2 weeks, we're talking about Easter Sunday. And we're going to have three opportunities to meet in person on that day. Here is the lineup, 9, 10, 11. Can you handle that? You do need to register ahead of time. We are glad that we're doing that ahead of time because those are beginning to fill up. And you'll want to get on our website at cccrockford.org. And see where you can register for Easter Sunday. 2 days before that will be our Good Friday service. That is also going to be here in person, and we ask you please to register for that. The reason we register is because we're trying to keep responsible as far as keeping things safe and having everybody wear masks. We're still going to follow the guidelines as they are morphing and as the numbers get better, and I'm looking forward to those things lifting along the way. So that's a good thing, too. In just a moment, we're going to begin worshiping together. I'm going to ask you, please, stand with me, and let's pray. Father, now, for this hour, we want to set aside the things of this world that preoccupy our minds, our attention, that tug at us, and we want to focus solely on you. Lord, we ask you to receive our praise. We know already that you look into our hearts and see us and know us. But here, Lord, those joining us online and we who are here together, we come together in a special way, each of us, to hear one another, to together lift up our words of praise and thanks to you. Father, we're here to remember Jesus. We thank you for the opportunity as the body of Christ to gather around your table today. And we are here, Father, to look at your word. We know that the things of this world aren't all we need to sustain us. We are sustained by every word that proceeds from your mouth. So today, open up our hearts and minds. Fill us with those good things. And Lord, build us up to be your people, your presence in our community, in this world this week. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, oh, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand.
I'll be reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 9 through 11. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Sword in every fight, the truth will chase away the night. 'Cause your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captives, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. That the word will never fail. I know that in every situation, you speak the power to prevail. Louder than every lie, my sword in every fight, the truth will chase away the night. Your name is power over darkness, broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. Mighty, it won't let us down or fail us. Your name is power. Your name is power.
With the speed you scatter darkness, light arrives in heaven, opens. Holy Spirit, let us hear it. And when you speak, the church awakens, and we believe the change is coming. Holy Spirit, let us see it. And when you speak, you scatter darkness, and light arrives in heaven, opens. Holy Spirit, let us hear it. The church awakens, we believe the change is coming. Holy Spirit, let us see it. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captives, and mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, struggle.
Hidden glory in creation,
beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. It didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you
there's a variety of things that take place during the Lord's Supper. Sometime I wish that I could just go around and kind of interview people and ask them, what is it you do as you take the bread and the cup in your hands? What is it that goes through your mind? What is the, if you want to call it the ritual or the thing that you do? Heard a lot of different people explain what they do from week to week, but I've never just sat and watched everybody. That would be uncomfortable, wouldn't it? Jesus said there is one main thing that should be happening. I know one of the things that we do is we show his death until he comes. We are testifying to one another and to anybody who would watch us We believe that Jesus died for us, and we believe he's going to come again. That's going to happen today as we observe this. We also, in doing this today, are showing that we belong in the family of God, that we belong to each other, that we share this thing in common, and we have this in common. It's something that even though I don't know other believers, I know as they do this, we're together. I know as we do this that we're giving thanks. When Jesus instituted it, he gave thanks. And we're encouraged to give thanks in everything. And so here today, even though we remember a loss and we remember the pain and the hardship, we're also here to give thanks. But there is one thing that Jesus especially flat out said that we're supposed to be doing here today. It's usually put on the front of a table if there's a physically set table. You know the words. Do this in remembrance of me. Jesus said, as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. So without interviewing you today and without asking you, what do you say to the Lord during this time? What goes through your mind as you do this? Let me urge you and myself, as we share the Lord's Supper together today, to do this one thing, to remember Jesus Christ, to remember what he did. Let's pray. Father, in no way would we want the sacrifice of Jesus to be neglected or forgotten. You've given us this time. Every week we gather to remember Jesus. And so right now, Lord, with simple reminders, a piece of bread, a cup of juice, our minds are taken back to the cross to see your love, to see your grace expressed, poured out for our sake through Jesus. And right now, Father, we remember him. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. At this time, we're going to dismiss from the room here the kids who are here to go to children's worship. And there is Mr. Matt and Miss Kate right over here to the side, guys, if you want to go there. I believe this morning the video that we have to show is from Good News Productions International. And this is a wonderful mission work that Central has partnered with for years. I'm just going to let it speak for itself. It is actually directed very much to you, our church family. And so I'm going to let it speak and then just follow it up as it plays today.
Hey, friends at Central Christian Church. This is Alan sending personal greetings to you all. from GMP office in Joplin, Missouri. I'm grateful for media and technology to allow us to meet in this way. Central, you have been a great partner to GMPI for the past 24 years. You have invested over $38,000 in creating quality, relevant media and sharing Jesus around the world. Your generosity has affected countless lives for Jesus through GMPI. Thank you. I want to give you a quick update about your impact through GMPI in 2020. As crazy as last year was, God opened many doors for GMPI to proclaim His gospel through creating relevant media, and we're so humbled. If I can use two words to describe GMPI in 2020, the words will be productivity and fruitfulness. The pandemic allowed GMPI to share Jesus more than ever. As a matter of fact, it was our most productive year. 2,290 projects were finished. Over 41 million people were impacted, and 16,049 people were discipled. Isn't that amazing? Because of the fruitful year we had, GMPI decided to seize the momentum and began to work of building up 100 more teams around the world that produce media and share Jesus in the years to come. Be on the lookout for an exciting public announcement on April the 8th, and we would love to have both your prayers and financial partnership. Sorry, I can't say much more about it now, but you will hear more about it later. We praise God for how He is using GMPI, and we praise God for how He is using your partnership to share the light of Jesus through GMPI. That's your impact, because we cannot do what we do without you. We love you, Central. We are so grateful for your unwavering monthly support, which provides remarkable stability for GMPI, and for all the differences you're making locally and globally through your mission partners. It is an honor to have your partnership in creating media and sharing Jesus. Thank you, and God bless you. I look forward to meeting you in person someday.
Isn't that wonderful? Man, if that doesn't light your fire, your wood's wet. And I'm just, when I first saw that video, I was thrilled to hear those numbers. We are part of that. We get to be part of that. And we are going to be really deliberate continuing to share how the giving that we do at Central accomplishes these kinds of things. Offering boxes in the back, you can give online. A lot of people have made that shift. And you can continue to send in money. Any of those ways, it gets here and it gets applied to those kinds of things that we just heard about today. Let's thank God for that together, okay? Father, thank you for giving us the means to be able to participate in the gospel just by our prayers and money that goes into projects like these that we have heard about today. Thank you for the good work of Good News Productions International, for the countless thousands and millions whose lives are being reached with the good news because of that effort that has gone on for many years now. And Father, I pray that you will keep our vision open to seeing how our giving is accomplishing and being used to do these things. We give the honor and glory to you, Father, and we pray that you'll bless that ministry and work as it reaches out around the world. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. A few years back, people started putting cameras in places where you could observe wildlife 24/7. You remember seeing some of those cameras that went on eagle nests in particular, and you could watch as the youngsters were hatched and growing up and the adventures of them going on in life through that. I don't know if you wake up at 3 in the morning, but there's something you can do. Watch those. And among the things that you could watch as they are raising their young is the moments when those young leave the nests. I was interested in that because I've heard stories about what parent birds do to get the babies to fly. And maybe we could learn something from them, I thought. Imagine how, just think about this, what it's like to be a baby bird who has never flown, and you're a couple hundred feet up on a cliff, and it's time. Time to throw yourself from the nest. So what that means is the parent birds are teaching the baby birds to do something they are afraid to do. It's interesting to watch. They show them how to fly. Sometimes they'll let them get a little bit hungry so that they are motivated to venture out to get food. Other times, they'll give them a little bit of a nudge toward the edge of the nest. And then, like in this picture that was just up, sometimes they just plain old kick them out. They don't have a choice. And those babies, little birds, learn to do what they were born to do and to be. It made me think of the way that God knew ahead of time that his church was going to need some prodding when it comes to taking the gospel outside of Jerusalem and into the uttermost parts of the world. The church is supposed to be an unhindered church. And so we're continuing in the book of Acts today in chapters 10 and 11. And there we're reading this story of the deliberate way that God is nudging his church forward to build the kingdom. Ready or not, here you go. And I want to get something on the table right in front of us this morning, just in case you're not aware of it or you have been trying not to speak of it or think of it. Right now, across the country, there has been an uncomfortable feeling in many church families over an issue that really should be a non-issue to most of us. I don't see much challenge in dealing with the question of a person's value in God's sight. If you're looking at Scripture specifically, it's pretty easy, isn't it, to look at God's Word together and to accept that a person's country of origin or a person's skin color or culture doesn't have anything to do with them when it comes to their worth in God's sight or their place in God's kingdom. I don't see how that should be a challenge. That issue was settled when God made one man, one woman, and from them all families of the earth descended. And when then Jesus offered himself as the Savior to whom? All people. That question has been settled. Have you turned into the fact that Scripture says that? That the concept of race is an anti-biblical concept? And wouldn't it honor God if we were to acknowledge that today? Wouldn't that honor God? Well, sure it would. And wouldn't it then honor God to acknowledge that today, with our actions as well as our words and our thoughts? Ah, and that's where the subject gets more challenging. And that's where Christian people have polarized in the last couple years. In theory, and I think in heart, most of us understand that a person's geopolitical and genetic makeup aren't supposed to be in our minds as we look at one another and decide how are we going to relate to one another. That shouldn't be an issue. But when you take history, when you take our current reality, that's kind of a challenging thing to sort through, isn't it? I'm going to settle that whole thing today. Nah. But here's what I would like to do. I think that in Acts chapters 10 and 11, it can help give us some help with that. And it's not going to answer every question you might have about how you're supposed to fix what it is that divides us from other people. But it may be that looking at this story together, by doing that together this morning, you and I can learn to ask a better set of questions. Questions like, what did God, who allowed all of this diversity, what did he have in mind for people of differing geopolitical backgrounds? And what does God have in mind ultimately for the variety of nations, tribes, languages, and peoples? And you might be sitting there saying this morning, well, I know the answer to that already. Okay, good. Maybe asking those questions and asking them over again and answering them could help us put aside some of the confusion and the challenge of this issue. Remember together with me that God went to some lengths to answer those questions for the early believers and for us. And here's what I see as we start into this story today. First of all, that caring about people's souls is God's main concern. If you'll be honest with me, we find it easier to be around certain people more than others. And because of that, I sometimes prefer to hang around with certain people. Amen? So do you. It's less work. So go through the list of reasons that you gravitate toward certain people and possibly why you gravitate away from certain people. Things like age, gender, education, language, skin tone, culture, sense of humor or lack thereof, interests, heart. Some of those characteristics bring us together and help us drift apart, don't they? In fact, I admired some of those characteristics so much about one particular girl that I dated her. And then I chose to marry her. And no one else. I excluded her among everyone else. That's okay, isn't it? This story in Acts chapter 10 and 11, get it open if you haven't opened it, that we're going to look at today is deeper than that. Peter didn't want to be around, hang around with Gentile people, non-Jewish people. And even though he was kind of a crusty fisherman guy, he still was a good Jew, and he really struggled because of the way that he and his brother Andrew had been raised up. You don't eat with a Gentile. You don't go into the house of a Gentile. You don't let those people into your house, especially overnight. You don't have them as friends, and by all means, you don't marry them. Peter needed to work on his understanding and his heart. And so God, in his great sense of humor, arranged for Peter to spend some time with some Gentiles. Cornelius of Caesarea, Gentile to the max. He was a Roman centurion. He had achieved advancement in the Roman army and become a prestigious leader. He was now over a group of soldiers making 15 times their pay rate. And interestingly, in the Bible, when centurions are mentioned, they're almost always seen as a person of great character. Cornelius is no exception. Cornelius has been seeking the Lord. He has been trying to be a good man. He is regularly praying. He is giving to the poor. He's trying. And so the Lord chooses Cornelius for a project that is going to launch in the church a whole new heart towards this group of people. He's told by an angel to send to the city of Joppa and bring back from there a man named Simon Peter. He's going to help him. So, not knowing really what's going on, Cornelius sends two servants and a trusted soldier to the city of Joppa to look for a guy named Simon Peter. And that's where we jump in this story, Acts chapter 10, verse 9. The next day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the housetop about the sixth hour to pray, and he became hungry and wanted something to eat. But while they were preparing it, he fell into a trance and saw the heavens opened and something like a great sheet descending, being let down by its four corners upon the earth. In it were all kinds of animals and reptiles and birds of the air. And there came a voice to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "By no means, Lord. For I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean." And the voice came to him again a second time, "What God has made clean, do not call common." This happened three times, and the thing was taken up at once to heaven. Now, the thought of eating something unclean was completely foreign to somebody Jewish. "Surely not, Lord. I've never eaten ham or oysters." It's the third time we've got a record of Peter correcting the Lord. The third time. How could God order such a thing? So while Peter is there on the rooftop trying to figure this thing out, three men show up at the door. They tell their story. And Peter begins to understand what it's all about. That we're supposed to look upon people as God's concern, even people who make us uncomfortable, even Gentile people, which you and I mostly are. Peter invites those Gentile men in to stay overnight. The next morning, they all head for Caesarea along with six other followers of Jesus who had previously been Jews. 33 miles, they're going to make a journey on foot. And not only will they travel together for those 2 days, but they will also spend a night lodging together along the way. A day earlier, it was unthinkable. But God wants us and them to look upon others as God's concern, even if they aren't the people we might tend to hang around with. Everybody has certain people that you like to hang around, don't you? We have a word for them. We call them friends. And it may be that you're really close to your family members, so you spend a lot of time getting together with your family. Or maybe you're not really close to your family, and so you have a certain group of people who are close friends. You get together with them. You hang around with them. If you grew up a gang member, that's where you're comfortable. You hang out with a gang. If you're a college student that likes to suck on a Starbucks coffee, that's your element, and that's where you go, and you hang around there. We all have a certain group of people we like to be around. God doesn't have to push us to hang out with those people. And the opposite is true too, isn't it? There are certain people that we really don't like so much to be around. There are people that are difficult to be around. Maybe they use rough language and that's hard for you to listen to. Maybe they smell bad. Maybe they act weird. Maybe you're the one that smells bad and acts weird. Maybe the people you have a hard time being around are those people who are self-important and uppity. Maybe they're from a different ethnic background. I'll bet some of those people live within a block or two of this church building. You know, over the years, I've had to be around some difficult people. Honestly, people that I wouldn't choose to be around. In rehab centers, courtroom hallways, jails, prisons. And if it was all just left up to me, I'd rather not be around those people. To hear their problems, to hear their filthy mouths, to hear their ignorance and wrong ideas about life. That makes me uncomfortable. They tire me out. There are some people who are pretty comfortable in those settings. I'm not one of them. I'd rather be around people like me. You know, people who are nearly perfect. But we are supposed to look upon every person as God's concern, aren't we? Jesus said in Matthew 5, "For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same?" So I'm looking at this story and I'm figuring out that if I'm going to share God's concern, I'm going to start caring, or I'm going to continue to care about people's souls, not their ethnic background. You see, a person's skin color, his accent, what he's wearing, whether or not he's handsome, all of those things are surface matters. But God took some measures to help bring Peter past that. God did that because looking at a person's heart rather than externals is God's point of view. Satan gets people caught up in this idea that what matters is appearances. And so guys look at a girl and they reduce the value of her to how good she looks. And girls spend their time then focusing on how they look instead of caring about their character. And we look at people and we decide if he's fun or if he's intelligent or if he is worthy of our attention, if he looks right to us. And if he doesn't, we move the other direction. Maybe he's dressed wrong. Maybe he's got a different skin tone. Maybe he has some physical defect, and we turn and we go the other way. We look too much on the outside. God told Samuel, "The Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks where? On the heart." Ladies, this is why scriptures say in 1 Peter, your adornment must not be merely external, braiding the hair, wearing gold jewelry, putting on dresses, not just the outside. Peter arrived at the house of Cornelius, the Gentile Roman army leader. Cornelius had gathered together all the people closest to him. You can bet they were Gentiles. And they were all there to hear what Peter had to say. Peter looked at this crowd. He walked into this situation. Look what he says in verse 34. So Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him." Partiality. The word there literally means, it's two words put together, it means to take or to receive the face. To be a face taker. God doesn't judge a person's worth by what's on the outside. He wants people who fear him and pursue a right relationship with him, regardless of what they look like. That is a matter of what is on the inside. So as you look at someone's outside, remember that God is looking inside for a person who will love him and obey him. How do you know if the person inside there is going to do that or not? God wanted Peter to understand. He wanted him to understand this about what Peter considered to be a very unlikely group of un-Jewish people gathered in Caesarea that day. And I imagine that God had it recorded so that you and I this morning could understand it about the people we think are unlikely. Not only does this remind us that a person's insides are much more important than their appearances, it also reminds us that the way God saves any one of us, the way that God saves any one person, is the way that he saves every person. It's the same. Peter needed a reminder of that. I'll bet we could use a reminder of that too. That salvation comes by grace through faith in God's plan. Way back in Genesis 17, God gave to the Jewish nation, he gave to Abraham first, the covenant sign of circumcision. And that had become the marking sign of Jewishness ever since. So that whenever a Gentile man wanted to convert, he wanted to become a Jew, he had to be circumcised. And for centuries, that was the thing that really defined you as Jewish. And so as Jewish people began to accept Jesus and become followers of Jesus, they brought with them this expectation that you have to go back and bring with you that old covenant before you can be welcomed into this new thing called the church. And they took it one step further. They also brought along all of the old extra traditions that they had. Traditions like don't ever eat with a Gentile. Don't ever allow a Gentile into your home. You got to keep those too. Now, Peter stands as a guest in a Roman army commander's house preaching the good news of Jesus to a crowd of Gentiles. Verse 38, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and made him to appear. And as Peter is speaking, While these words are leaving his mouth and these people are receiving the message and believing it, God does something that has never happened before quite like it did then. While they're believing this, God pours out his Holy Spirit on this group of Gentile people, and they begin to speak in other languages, to speak in tongues. Peter would reflect back on this situation, and he would say, it's just like what happened to us on the first day when God poured out his Spirit and we spoke other languages. And Peter would understand the message from God loud and clear that day, that God was accepting these people, these very un-Jewish people, into his kingdom. He still hadn't sorted this whole thing out. He would struggle with this. Maybe he knew what it meant up here, but he was still struggling with consistently living what he taught. God was calling these people, everyone now, to repent and be saved. So if you're like me and you don't quite always get it right, don't despair. We're in good company. We're not the first people to stumble over this issue of grace and how God's grace applies to ourselves and how it applies to everybody else. God went to great lengths to help Peter get it. And he's got it recorded here for us too. I think I understand grace up here. I think I've got a pretty good grasp of what the Bible has to say about it. I understand that the whole plan of salvation is a gift that God gives that I cannot personally possibly earn or deserve. I understand that. I understand that salvation is not a result of works so that no one can boast. And with all of that in my head, I still sometimes choose instead to reassure myself that I'm saved not because of the perfect sacrifice of Jesus, but because of the sacrifices I make. Because I don't use bad language, or because I'm seen in the right places, acting the right way at the right times. I get the good works cart in front of the salvation horse sometimes. And I especially do that when I apply it to other people in a negative way. I can even fine-tune the list of good works that contain things that really are more a matter of my opinion than a matter of salvation. I'm really good at that. How about you? Just like Peter needed help in understanding and putting this into practice when it came to Gentile people, I think this morning I and you probably need some help with this sometimes. So here we are reading about it this morning. God really took some measures to get Peter to understand his plan to offer salvation by grace through faith to every person. And no sooner had Peter made it back to Jerusalem than he was met with a group of people, guess what? Calling him out for associating with the Gentiles. So let me ask every person listening this morning, you like to be questioned for what you've done? You want to be ridiculed? You want to become a spectacle? You want to be an outcast? My guess is that the answer to each of these questions for each of you is no. But too often, that's what it means when we have to decide between what God plainly tells us to do and what somebody else wants to decide for you to do. We already looked at that a little bit earlier in the book of Acts. Most workplaces, by the way, have already decided for you that that's not a place where you talk about your faith in Jesus Christ. For the most part, public schools have declared to be the same way. God isn't so welcomed there. And by the way, if you happen to work there, you better not try to welcome him there. Mass media, social media can also get to be this way. It means you and I have a decision to make. Will we listen to those voices that tell us, no, don't talk about this, or will we listen to God? So let's learn from this story one more thing, and that is that doing what God tells us is His rightful place in our lives. Do you believe that? That is God's rightful place. We already read back in chapter 4 how Peter and John stood up together in front of the Jewish council. Remember what they said? We must obey God rather than men. Good for Peter. He understands this important part of following Jesus. He's putting it into play all throughout this story. The whole point of this wasn't to get Peter to eat bacon and eel pie. He was teaching Peter there's no such thing as people who don't matter to God. That's the message that the church really needs to light on today, brothers and sisters. That's the message. Rather than getting sucked into a worldly argument that drags us away from the most important thing, which is people's souls. We're supposed to be reaching out to everyone with the good news. Do you think that Peter didn't understand that he would be in hot water when he got back to Jerusalem? Surely he knew. He took along with him 6 other believers who stayed together to meet these Gentiles. He ate with them. He showed his approval of them. And word got back to Jerusalem and Peter heard about it. Chapter 11, verse 17. Here's what he says. If then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way? So what happens when we're careful and we're faithful to do what God tells us to do? Well, in this case, Peter got in hot water for it. He got questioned. Think about it. If it had been up to these people in Jerusalem who did this, would Peter have ever gone to the house of Cornelius, the centurion in Caesarea? Nobody would have. And you and I could be in a very similar situation right now. What if we just listened to the people who just don't care about others? Or what if we listened to the people who want the church to entangle itself in a struggle that ignores that people's greatest need is to be saved from sin? Would we ever take the good news about life in Jesus to people? Would we ever make disciple-making our focus and our priority? In 18th century England, there lived a cobbler named William, a young man who kept a map of the world on the wall in his workshop. That map was there to help him pray for the nations of the world because William had a burden on his heart to reach out to the lost people of his time. And when he stood to share that burden at a meeting of ministers one day, he was told by one of the men there, "Young man, sit down. When God wants to convert the heathen, he will do it without your help or mine." But William Carey chose to listen to God and to give him the place that he deserves when it comes to being told what to do. And he eventually went to India, and he started a missionary work there that had never been started. And for the next 40 years, William Carey worked on translating either all of or portions of the Bible into 34 different languages in India. Somebody is going to tell you, don't offend. Somebody is going to tell you, don't pressure. Don't come across like a radical. Don't speak like following Jesus is the only way. But God has told you and me that we are His ambassadors, that we are pleading on God's behalf to the world. Be reconciled to God. Paul said in Galatians, if he was still trying to please men, still trying to please people, he wouldn't be a servant of Christ. You know what? I probably like you. I can safely say that. I probably like you. But I'm looking for God's applause, not yours. You should be doing the same. You should be after God's approval, by giving God the rightful place in your life. And I believe that we have this story tucked here in the book of Acts because God wants us to be more concerned about what God thinks and less concerned about what other people think. So we have some choices to make today, this week, the rest of the month. Easter Sunday, by the way, is 2 weeks away. And this year, we can bring someone along. We can bring someone along. The rest of your friends might wonder why you are now bringing along somebody who was on the outside of your circle before, but now you're bringing them in. Will you choose to do it? Even other Christians might look at you kind of cockeyed because you chose to put yourself in a place where people needed to hear about Jesus. You know what? That's okay. Let them watch cockeyed when some of those people are baptized into Christ and begin life forever with Him right in front of them. God shows no partiality. But in every nation, anyone who fears Him and does what is right is acceptable to Him. Whoever you are this morning, that means you. No matter who you are. That's one of the beautiful features of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is good news for every person and good news for us to share with every person. Amen. Today, I hope that message encourages you. I hope that if it means you needed a kick in the pants, okay, that you've got that. All right, let's go on. And maybe it means this morning that you're for the first time realizing God wants me. God invited me into this, like He invited those people. And you're thinking today, all right, what do I need to do now to become part of that? And I hope that's a question that's on your mind if you're not already a follower of Christ. For every person joining us online today, we want to help you make next steps to begin a relationship with Jesus Christ. And we're asking you, please don't just finish this time online and then go on to the next thing. Please, get in contact with us. Help us make a connection and begin a relationship where we can look at God's Word together and talk to you about your relationship with Christ. You're here presently, right now, physically here today, and you've got some decisions to make. I hope that for everybody seated here this morning, what you're thinking is, who is this person now? Where is this group now? Who are these people that I didn't before hang out with that now I realize that's something I need to do? I hope that's what's on your heart today. Would you stand with me? We're going to have a time of decision, the time where we think now and start to work out what is it we do with God's Word and what we've heard today. Let's pray together. Father, we do come before You, having looked into Your Word. We want to learn what it is You want us to learn there. So I pray, Father, that we, like Peter, will be grown up more because of what You did with a house of a man who was by many regarded very far from You, and yet You had plans for his life, as You do for every person, that You want them to know You, to come to repentance and a knowledge of the truth. Father, for whoever that is that You place in front of us, I pray You'll give us the right heart, the right words. Father, for those who are hearing this today and understanding that's themselves, they need to begin this journey with You, I pray that today will be the day for making those decisions and beginning life in Jesus. It's in His name that we pray. Amen. That's going to conclude our time of worship for this first hour here this morning. Thank you for joining us online if you've been there online. And again, cccrockford.org/connect. That'll get you in touch with us pretty quickly, or just get on our website and you can contact us there. But for everybody else who's here this morning, it's just, hey, how are you doing this morning? And talk to people. That's an easier way. All right. So on your way out today, we encourage that. I do encourage you, keep moving as you're visiting. That's all right. We want you to visit and hang out. And the great news is, as the weather gets better, we can do that a lot more outside too. So 2 weeks, Easter Sunday. Get registered for that online. Friday, before Easter Sunday, will be Good Friday services here at the church building. Also register for that. And I think that's all the things that we need to announce. Let's pray as we get ready to go. Father, thank you for being here. You promised to be here when we gather together in your name, especially in the context of prayer and seeking you together. And so, according to your promise, we thank you. And thank you for the promise that as we go from here, we are not leaving your presence. You have said.